Good morning, everyone. Can I welcome you to the first meeting in 2016 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. Apologies have been received from Siobhan McMahon. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. The committee will consider whether to take item four, consideration of advisor candidates, for its inquiry into the circumstances surrounding the recent closure of the fourth road bridge in private. Are members all agreed? Thank you, we are agreed. Agenda item two is draft budget 2016-17. The committee will take oral evidence from the Scottish Government's draft budget on the Scottish Government's draft budget 2016-17. The committee took evidence from a number of stakeholders on the 25th of November 2015 prior to the publication of the draft budget to allow witnesses to comment on the outcomes of the current year's spending and suggest what more might need to be done both in 2016-17 and beyond to meet the Government's targets. Today's sessions with the Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure, Investment in Cities and the Minister for Housing and Welfare will allow members to follow up on these sessions now the budget has been published. Now the draft budget has been published. Firstly, can I welcome Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure, Investment in Cities, who is accompanied today by Mike Baxter, Director for Finance, Corporate and Analytical Services, and Andrew Watson, Deputy Director for Financial Strategy at the Scottish Government. Can I invite you, Cabinet Secretary, to make any short introductory remarks?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, delighted to be with you this morning and also welcome the chance to give evidence on how, in particular, my portfolio spending helps meet the Scottish Government's climate change targets, which I believe may be the focus of the committee's budget scrutiny, given the comments you've just made, Convener. The Scottish Government's purpose, as is well known, is to deliver sustainable economic growth and to create the opportunity for all of our citizens to flourish. And we believe that with a relentless focus on tackling inequality and boosting productivity, we can create the foundations for a stronger and more inclusive economy. At the same time, we are on track to reach our 2020 interim climate change targets. This year's draft budget should be seen in the context of the recently refreshed Infrastructure Investment Plan, which supports the objectives set out in the Scotland's Economic Strategy and the Scottish Government's Programme for Government. This draft budget is a budget to invest in, to protect and to extend our economic recovery. Around £4 billion is to be invested over the next year in infrastructure, and that includes house building, transport and digital links. We have successfully delivered 30,000 homes over the course of this Parliament. I do remember some time ago being Minister for Housing, and that target was met with some scepticism at the time, but we are successfully delivering that target and are committing to an increase of £90 million in affordable housing supply compared to 2015-16, and a total investment of around £690 million in housing. And that helps to support our overall commitment to delivering 50,000 new affordable homes by 2020-21. We're also providing further investment of £130 million in Scotland's digital infrastructure to help towards our 2017 target to ensure 95% of premises in Scotland have access to next-generation broadband. And the IIC portfolio plays a significant role in helping achieve the Scottish Government's purpose, primarily through contributing to three strategic objectives: wealthier and fairer, safer and stronger, and greener. In line with Scotland's economic strategy, the majority of the portfolio spend is focused on investment in transport, including low-carbon transport and water infrastructure. So I'll just expand briefly on these if I could, Convener. First of all, transport infrastructure is a critical part of the budget, and since 2007, this Government has invested over £15 billion in transport. In 2016-17, we are continuing to invest over £1 billion annually in public transport and other sustainable transport options to encourage people out of their car. The increase in the roads budget is, of course, a result of the recent changes to the EU statistical classification for the Government's programme of revenue-financed infrastructure, meaning that the funding for the cost of constructing the Aberdeen Western and Peripheral route is included in this year's budget figures. Our investment in the strategic road transport network will ultimately support the low-carbon agenda, whether through providing efficient links for public transport and the new generation of low-carbon vehicles, or also taking traffic off local roads to improve conditions for active travel or facilitating modal shift. Alongside that, of course, is the completion of the new fourth replacement crossing. The recent temporary closure of the fourth road bridge for essential repairs has, I think, served to highlight the need for the new crossing, and I'm very pleased that this budget will allow the new crossing to progress towards completion in line with the latest timescales previously advised. And funding for the fourth road bridge capital maintenance has been protected, and this year is £9 million, which is an increase of £4 million from 2015-16. That matches, as it always does, the agreed programme of works. As part of our efforts to deliver a transformational vision of the complete decarbonisation of road transport by 2050, particularly through the electrification of transport as well as modal shift, we are providing leadership in relation to, first of all, pump priming low-carbon technology, modal shift and active travel initiatives, and promoting associated networks. We're working with partners to deliver actions from Switched On Scotland, that's our electric vehicle roadmap, Charge Place Scotland, our electric vehicle charging network, currently comprises around 1,000 publicly accessible charging bays throughout the country, including over 100 rapid charge points, making it one of the most comprehensive networks in Europe. We've also launched the Active Travel Vision and the first ever National Active Travel Summit, bringing together key stakeholders to seek support for our longer term aspirations to increase the uptake of cycling and walking for shorter everyday journeys. We are sustaining investment in active travel at the record level of approximately £39 million in 2016-17, and we're also continuing to invest over £1 billion per year in public and sustainable transport to encourage people onto public transport and active travel modes. We'll also support the ERDF, European Regional Development Fund, interventions on sustainable transport over the period up to 2020, which would yield match funding of up to £37.5 million in order to assist in the delivery of active travel hubs. Low-carbon transport hubs and a national smart integrated ticketing scheme will also be developed. It will also encourage the freight industry to reduce emissions through the mode shift, revenue support and waterborne freight grant schemes. And as announced in June 2015, we will support a continuation of the Future Transport Fund to provide the infrastructure necessary to enable the uptake of low-emission vehicles and other sustainable forms of transport. We'll also continue to invest in infrastructure and behaviour change initiatives to encourage cycling and walking, working in partnership with local authorities across the country. We also intend, convener, to complete the electrification of the Glasgow-Edinburgh rail line by December 2016 and continue the delivery of key improvements to the route between Aberdeen and Inverness. A few comments on Scottish Water. We are committed to a significant programme of investment in Scotland's water and sewerage infrastructure for the 2015-21 period, worth £3.5 billion. And that includes £250 million to upgrade Glasgow's wastewater infrastructure to improve the environment of the River Clyde and also to tackle flooding. That will also enable economic growth, safeguard public health and protect our environment. And on flooding specifically, obviously very topical, Mr Swinney previously announced that this year we will provide £4 million to the local authority areas affected most by recent flooding in Hoyke, Newcastleton, Dumfries, Alloth and other localities, as mentioned by the Deputy First Minister yesterday, to help with recovery and to help households and businesses access the support they need. Funding for the flood forecasting service has been protected by the budget settlement put forward in December. Funding for the system is provided directly by the government and in addition to the grant and aid that we provide to SEPA. As a hydro nation, we can capitalise on global economic opportunities and support the good stewardship of water resources. We've made resources available from within the Scottish Water Budget to promote that agenda, which includes a Climate Justice Fund. In relation to procurement reform, we will continue to invest in the Scottish model of procurement through the procurement resources transfer from the core Scottish Government Administration budget, and that will secure the continued provision of shared services to underpin the transformation of public procurement in Scotland, delivering further savings and maximising the social, environmental and economic benefits of public purchasing activity. We will, for example, continue to ensure that contracts for our large infrastructure projects include community benefit clauses to achieve continued employment and training opportunities. And in 2016-17, the Scottish Futures Trust will continue to work to enhance value for money for infrastructure investment across the public sector in Scotland. That includes working in partnership with others to progress delivery of the extended pipeline of revenue-funded investment and to support other innovative ways of financing and procuring infrastructure. Convener, the 2016-17 budget is, I believe, once again a robust plan to improve infrastructure and to increase house building to ensure that all Scots can benefit from our post-recession growth. And with that, I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for that opening statement. And perhaps I could kick off our questions then. Clearly, the main area of interest to this committee is that of expenditure on transport. And you indicated in your opening remarks that some of the estimated increase in the road budget is attributable to the reclassification by the Office of National Statistics of the expenditure, estimated construction costs of the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route. Do you have a figure for how much the increase in the road budget would have been without that reclassification?
Well, I think we have the director, deputy director for finance here, who can answer specifically. But I think it's of the order. The difference is of the order of £180 million in this financial year. So, if you deduct that from the total that we have, you would see that the budget that we would have for infrastructure, roads, transport, roads infrastructure, would have been less in absolute terms than it would have been last year if you deduct that from the sum. But it's around £180 million in this year.
Okay, but the figure. The percentage increase in the road budget, including the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route, is in the region of 18%. So, just trying to get an indication of what that percentage increase would have been. But assuming that it would still have been in the magnitude of over 10%, that's a significant increase. We have a reduction in the rail service budget of 7% and 26.5% increase in sustainable and active travel. My question to you, Cabinet Secretary, would be, do you feel that the current balance of transport expenditure is appropriate given the very clear policy commitment that the Scottish Government has to reducing carbon emissions?
Yeah, I'm happy to answer that, and also I'm sure that Andrew can work out the percentage figure that you were asking about, Convener. As you say, about an 18% increase in the road budget, which includes that, if you like, exceptional cost of the reclassification for AWPR, around a 0.3% increase in the bus service budget and a 26.5% increase in the sustainable and active travel budget. So that shows that the biggest increase we do have against the reducing budget is for the active travel budget. And of course, you will appreciate, I think as every member of the committee will, that the government has to make choices in relation to its budget. So the changes in the budget that we've made don't reflect a further shift in activity from what we've done previously, which is to increase the active and sustainable travel budget. The large increase in the roads budget, as I've said, is to do with the reclassification of the AWPR. And also the transport budget, I think it's worth saying, reflects contractual requirements, maintenance and upgrades, reflecting transport priorities. Almost 90% of the transport budget is legally committed in advance. So in terms of investing in transport, I think we're doing what we said we would do in our manifesto, developing the infrastructure to support electric cars. And of course, electric cars have to travel on roads and you have to invest in roads, as do buses, as in many cases do bicycles as well. So I think the balance, to answer your question, that we have is the right balance. And I think it's also important to point out within that the substantial increase we've had in terms of active travel and sustainable travel, low carbon travel, I think from about £21 million 3 years ago to £39 million last year and again this year. So yes, I think the balance is right. Of course, we'd like to do more, but we are given our budget and have to work within that.
Okay, that's helpful. Would you be able to provide the committee with a split in the percentage increase in sustainable and active travel is a significant 26.5%. It'd be useful if we could have a figure for both sustainable travel and for active travel.
Yeah, happy to do that.
Okay, thank you. Just on active travel, you mentioned that expenditure on active travel is at a record level and that the government intends to sustain that in the financial year 2016-17. You also talked about the importance of match funding. Can I just ask you then about the Cycling, Walking and Safer Streets Fund, which is the only significant cycling cash to go directly from the government to local authorities. It's been highlighted by cycling organisations in evidence to the committee that they have a concern that that particular expenditure, notwithstanding your commitment to sustain active travel at the current levels, may be under threat, and if that is the case, it will make it difficult to secure the match funding through other funding streams that are currently available.
Yeah, I think as perhaps underlying your question, the convener, there's no question that this budget does impact on local authorities as well, and where that has an impact on match funding, that would obviously be a matter of concern. We do intend to work with local authorities, though, to maximise the opportunities that we have for active travel. We've maintained our commitment to that. So, first of all, you want to maximise the opportunities that there might exist for match funding projects, mainly, I think, to do with the work we do through SUSTRANS and different individual local authorities or groups of local authorities. So I think we will have to work further with local authorities to make sure that on their side they're able to take up those opportunities in terms of match funding. And one reason for that is not just the benefits of active and sustainable travel, whether it's cycle paths or so on, but also because these contracts, which tend to be in the scheme of the portfolio that I'm responsible for, relatively small contracts, have got a disproportionate benefit in terms of local employment and local contractors as well. So that's something we don't want to lose sight of. I'm conscious I might want to come back on a point. Yeah. I don't necessarily agree with this or the previous question. So I understand the point you're making, Queener, and it's our intention to make sure that we still maximise, first of all, by providing the budget on our side for local authorities to match and to work with local authorities. Part of that change, it's worth saying, in relation to the capital provision for local authorities, is a profiling issue. Now, that is still an issue, but what we're saying is that the reduced capital provision for local authorities this year will be compensated for in future years. So it is a profiling issue. In fact, that happens in a number of areas within the budget in my portfolio. So they will have this money in future years, and I think these projects tend not to be just within one year in any event, so that will help mitigate the effects of that. I don't know if you wanted to add to that, Mike.
Yeah, just to come back on the it was actually the previous point in terms of the motorways and trunk roads budget. The increase of 18%, the revised budget or the draft budget for 16-17, 820 million, and of that 183 million relates to the AWPR. Mm-hmm. So taking that into account, the budget, or taking that out, the revised budget would have been 637, which actually would have been a reduction in the motorway and trunk roads budget of circa 9%.
Okay. Well, that's helpful clarification. Thank you for that. Thank you for the speed of the clarification as well.
That's okay.
I'm gonna, pass on to Claire.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you very much for your opening statement, which answered a lot of the questions I actually had for you this morning. You seem very confident that the transport-related infrastructure expenditure plans in the budget, for the draft budget for next year and for this year, will support the government in reaching its climate change targets. But you also mentioned the long-term goals about electrification, about the change in behaviours and all the things that have to happen from the public point of view, including the purchasing of vehicles. And I just wondered if you could give us an insight into how that will be monitored and the progress and to ensure that your long-term goals are achieved in these areas.
Well, it's done. The monitoring of it is done jointly by officials across different portfolios. Obviously, the Dr. Aileen McLeod's portfolio and Richard Lockhead's portfolio. There has been a ministerial group established, which includes a number of cabinet secretaries and ministers to help monitor that process as well. And you're right to say there's a number of different ways in which we intend to tackle that. So some of the very large electrification programmes have a direct environmental benefit. Electrically powered railway tends to be far more environmentally friendly than obviously diesel powered. But it's also about behaviour change. So we've done that in relation to active travel and also a number of things. So car clubs, low carbon vehicles. And as I mentioned in the opening statement, the probably essential first point to getting that off the ground is to have a good network of charging points. And that's taken us some time to do, as it has across Europe, but I think we're at the head, ahead of the game now in terms of doing that. People won't invest in an electric car before they know they've got the infrastructure there to support it. I think the other thing I would say, which I didn't mention previously as well, is there's also going to be, I think, unforeseen or perhaps unanticipated changes which will help us in relation to this, which, for example, may include driverless cars, which are very prominent just now. And the opportunities presented by driverless cars are pretty substantial. Of course, the technology is not exactly where it needs to be yet. I think the latest I heard yesterday was 2020 before you're seeing that at any kind of scale. But that also provides real scope for driving fuel efficiency and a change in the way that the cars that we currently use are fueled, so you can have much more in terms of electrical vehicles. So, but all of these initiatives will be taken forward and monitored through not least the ministerial working group that I mentioned, but by the officials working across portfolios.
Thank you.
If I can continue this particular theme, Cabinet Secretary, we've had evidence from Dr. Gardner of WWF Scotland suggesting that a 300% increase in annual vehicle emissions reduction rates are required by 2017 to meet the emissions reduction target specified in RPP2. And there appears to be a dearth of policies to achieve this. Do you agree with that analysis? And if you don't, can you clarify the government's position on it?
Well, I'd say a couple of things. First of all, the latest year for which figures are available, which is 2013, showed that transport emissions had reduced for the sixth consecutive year. Now, I know that was also at least partly to do with economic activity in the recession, but that suggests, I think, that we're starting to bear down on the historic trend of rising emissions. And since the peak in emissions in 2007, transport emissions have fallen by 1.9 megatons. I'm not sure if that's the right unit of measurement, but that's what it seems to be, MTCO2E. That's equivalent to a 13% reduction over the six-year period from 2007 to 2013. And in 2013, it's worth bearing in mind, given that many of these targets are set with reference to 1990, that's the base year level. They were below that level for the third successive year in 2013. So emissions abatement is a long-term agenda with our transformational vision of the complete decarbonisation of road transport by 2050, particularly through the electrification of transport as well as modal shift. And RPP2, which you mentioned, published in June 2013, I think outlines our approach to achieving those transport emissions abatement over the period to 2027. There's four key areas in which we intend to take this forward. We have, I think, given some strategy on this, which is decarbonising vehicles, which I've mentioned, promoting sustainable communities. I think there's more for us to do there. For example, be much more explicit about how people get from their door to where they want to go in a sustainable way, looking at the whole journey that they have and realising they might use different modes, say, perhaps by cycling to a train station, how they then are able to get on the train, make sure they can either keep their bike with them or access another bike at the other end. So I think there's more that we have to do in relation to that. But also I think we have to engage with businesses much more around sustainable transport. And as I mentioned during the statement, ensuring the efficient use of the road network, there's a great deal more that we can do there which can help in terms of emissions abatement as well. So I do think that we have put together within RPP2 and subsequently measures which will allow us to achieve the targets that we've set.
Okay. A lot of store has been put by this electrification of vehicles. Now I'm thinking of changing my car this year, Cabinet Secretary. Is there an incentive for me to switch to, available for me to switch to electric, an electric vehicle as opposed to the conventional fueled vehicles?
Speaking for the company, which to give you advice on that, I would say, there are incentives and there are specific tax incentives, which obviously we don't organise. That's done through the UK government in relation to low carbon transport. But I think whether it's an incentive or not, I think the crucial thing is the point I made to Claire Adamson, that you really wouldn't want to invest in that unless you knew you had the support infrastructure around about you. And I mentioned when I spoke about the different types of charging stations, for some people a rapid charging station is essential. because you can have one which could take a long time for a car to recharge. I mean, the batteries are getting more and more efficient all the time. The people that I've spoken to that have bought electric or low-carbon vehicles have said they wouldn't go back to any other kind of vehicle. They found that, even going back a few years now, to be very beneficial. And certainly having seen some of the cars which are now electric, I mean, this one is virtually, well, you've got the Tesla, obviously, but you've got some BMW cars which are like supercars. So, you know, the image of low-carbon vehicles, electric vehicles in the past was very different from what the reality is today. So I think there are quite a number of incentives to having electric or low-carbon vehicles.
Well, I'll investigate that. but maybe more to the point is heavy goods vehicles obviously make up a very high proportion of emissions in our roads network. What about that section of the market, if you like? Are there any initiatives been taken on that front?
Yeah, I mean, there's two things, not necessarily an initiative that we're taking, but certainly the private sector's taking the initiative to try and make, as it does with all, I'm sure it's products, to make these large engines more efficient over time, and they follow the same pattern as the domestic car has in becoming more efficient. But the second thing that we've taken the initiative on is in driver training, which can make a huge difference to companies who are trying to reduce their fuel bills, essentially. But obviously that has the knock-on effect of reducing emissions as well. And driver training can dramatically reduce the cost of fuel. So many companies, large and small, have now invested, and we've tried to point them towards this as well, in driver training initiatives, which, as I say, it can be safer driving, but it's certainly more efficient driving. And by more efficient, it looks at the bottom line for companies. It reduces what they pay in fuel, but the benefit to us, of course, is that reduces the emissions as well.
Okay, thank you. My follow-up question is with regards to sustainable and active travel, which you've already covered to some extent, but we've heard evidence that return on investments in sustainable and active travel is very substantial indeed, and that a target benchmark for sustainable and active travel budget should be 10% of the total transport budget. Do you feel that the current level, which works out at something like 1.8% for the draft budget, is sufficient? Do you want to build up towards that 10%? Do you accept that 10% target, and do you want to build up to that over the coming years?
Well, I think if we go back to the previous response I'd made to the convener, that much of the transport budget is long-term contractual agreements which we have year on year, and also to the point that I made that much of the expenditure, for example, on roads transport benefits active travel as well. So I'm not sure that 10% figure can just be drawn from the active and sustainable travel budget. I think there's much else that we do which tends to help in terms of sustainable travel. You can argue, as I've said previously, for example, that travelling on a train, which you'll be increasingly able to do, which is powered by electric lines, is far more sustainable than other forms of transport. So right across the transport budget, I think we're doing work to make transport more sustainable. Allocations to transport projects that we make, though, tend to be made following evidence gathering, public consultations, and various impact assessments. Now, I must admit, when I got this job, and I think we've improved even since my time, the amount of pre-consultation that's done on large projects is striking, and is now often copied by other countries that look at the way that we do some of these large projects, and we do the pre-consultation before actually doing that. So these, I'll give you one example, the A9 project, which is probably the biggest project on the books currently. We've looked at that not just in terms of the road itself, but there is an active travel route that goes alongside the A9, but in a number of places it's not in very good condition. So what we said is it possible in future, when we look at the contracts, both for upgrading the road and also for maintaining it subsequently, that we can try and incorporate a contract which looks after that active travel side of it as well. So I don't think that we should just look at what the active and sustainable travel budget provides. I think it's right across the transport piece. And in that regard, I am convinced that we've got the balance right, although obviously we will look to do more. We have done. We've dramatically increased the budget for active and sustainable travel, as I've mentioned already, up to £39 million, and we'll continue to try to do more in future.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Could I continue on the theme of active travel, Cabinet Secretary? You'll be aware of the evidence we've received from Spokes, who've argued that we should really be spending 1% of the trunk roads budget. That should really be transferred to active travel. I don't need to convince you of the merits of active travel, both in terms of health and, of course, in climate change. And in a personal, my personal view has been that if I was in your place, I would ask for transfer of funding from health to the active travel budget, because there's a strong argument about the preventative nature of active travel, but that's maybe another argument for another day. What's your view about Spokes' proposal to beef up the active travel budget?
I think, to be honest, I'd be at risk of repeating myself from the previous answer I've given to Adam Ingram, because I think much of what I've said in response to that question applies here. I mean, it's worth bearing in mind we've invested over £137 million in active travel since the start of the 2011 spending review. And as I mentioned already, that our plans for this year will add a further £39 million to that. As we announced in June, we'll extend the future transport fund into 2016-17 to match what was a record budget for active and sustainable travel last year. And that currently supports the development of priority active travel infrastructure projects in partnership with councils, like I've mentioned, projects to accelerate the widespread adoption of low-carbon vehicles, as mentioned. So I think we have done substantially more than we have done in the past, than previous administrations have done in the past, and we will look to increase that. I think it's an increasing investment that we're making in active travel. I don't think it all comes down, as I've said, to that budget. For example, just at a very basic level, that budget does not include what local authorities put in terms of match funding for many of these projects as well. There's one project, for example, in my own area, which is part of the National Cycle Network, which is a fantastic offline walking and cycling road right the way along the Hillfoots in Clipmanisher, which is a tremendous, some of the stuff I've seen in Stirling and in the Highlands as well, tremendous advances in terms of, so I think we want to continue to invest in that over time, but it's not the case that the only advances for active and sustainable travel are those which come from that particular budget.
Thank you. My final question, I was going to raise some more issues about electric vehicles, but I think Adam Ingram has stolen my thunder somewhat on that issue. But could I raise the issue about modal shift? I mean, yourself and predecessors have quite rightly talked about the importance of modal shift. But I'll give you one practical example. As you know, we did a major inquiry into freight. And it's obviously very, very important to get freight off the road, onto rail and onto sea as well. But if you look at the reality of it, the Freight Facilities Grant, as you know, has not been spent for the last 4 years. Now, I'm not necessarily blaming government, because it takes two to tango, you've got to put the projects in. But clearly, it's one thing to talk about modal shift, but the reality is it hasn't really happened as far as freight's concerned. I mean, what can you do to turn this around and ensure that we get freight off roads and onto sea, particularly where there's been very few applications for seaborne freight, which is vitally important?
Yeah, I think you make the point quite rightly that it takes two to tango. It's actually a three-cornered relationship that's going on here, really, which explains, I'm not sure it's true that there's been no budget spent in the last 4 years on Freight Facilities Grant, but it is right to say it's quite difficult to sometimes get that money out the door. For example, I think the budget at Westminster was abolished in 2005 because they weren't spending it, and despite that, we've kept this budget here. What has been the problem has often been the case that it's a private sector initiative or a third-party initiative to look at this in the first place, where a company wants to try and invest in new freight modal shift. And there's a European element to it as well, where often state aid can be an inhibitor. We found that, and we've looked very closely at ways in which we can try and get that minimised. But there is, I think, a very promising FFG initiative, I think, in terms of, I think it's Highland Spring coming off just now. The other thing I would say is that you're right to say, well, we've said we want to do this, but one of the difficulties was very obvious to me when we had the recent problems with the Channel Tunnel. When you see all the fish, and I'm sure Alec Johnson will know about this, the way that the industry has targeted road freight to actually get its goods to market. And then you'd think, if you weren't that close to the industry, it's a perfect opportunity to move that to air freight because of the problems in terms of road freight. We could not convince industry, and the reason for that was they had their established routes, and also because of the low value, high volume, I think I've got that right, it didn't make sense for them. So there are real problems with doing this, but I wouldn't mistake the fact that we've had some difficulty in getting that budget out the door in previous years with any lack of commitment on our part, and also give you the assurance that we're looking very closely at what have been the obstacles so far. Very often these projects get advanced to quite a late stage, and the private sector company does not see them through for whatever reason, because they have to have that initiative. There's ones in Fife I can think of. So we are committed to it, and we're committed to trying to improve their ability to fund it in future.
Just for the record, on memory, just in terms of the Freight Facilities Grant, I think there's three different grants that allow a modal shift. Certainly our advisor and our Freight Inquiry confirmed that there was no spending Freight Facilities Grant for a four-year period. It may have changed since then, of course. I think the last one was Montrose Harbour had a FFG. But I'm subject to any correction from other committee members. The other issue, and final issue, I just want to flag up, is again for modal shift. Do you share my view that it's very important that we incentivise drivers, for example, to start looking at using the train more? So I'll give you a sort of local example from Highlands and Islands. Obviously, I fully support the dualling of the A9, and that expenditure is welcomed. Clearly, when that's complete, you will see, I think, a growth in traffic on the A9, which of course is safer as well, because dualling is safer than single carriageway. But if there isn't equivalent spend on rail, and I know there is some spending on rail, what you're going to do is encourage drivers to stay in their cars and not to use rail. So what I would just flag up is, as a general policy, I mean, have you looked at all at saying, if we spend X in road, we'll spend the same in rail? I mean, the example the convener gave at the start is there's a 7.1% reduction in the rail service budget. Is that something you've thought about when it comes to planning services? Because the equivalent, if you just look at the A9, I think it's something $3 billion you're spending on the A9 in memory. There is some spend on rail, but my guess is about a tenth of that. But your finance officials can perhaps correct me if that's wrong. Do you see the logic of that argument, spending the same on rail as on road?
Well, I think the reality is, if you look at the expenditure that we've had on rail, around £5 billion of a programme during the current control period, whether it's the Borders Rail, Airdrie to Bathgate, the improvements to Aberdeen, all sorts of different, even Stirling, Alawak and Cardiff in my own area. I saw the government was being attacked recently in the media because of the level of borrowing that's there for the RAB, the resource asset base. We have borrowed heavily and we've invested heavily in rail. But I don't think you can say, one thing to say that you should have in mind the impact on railways when you're doing a roads project, that you cannot go and start a major roads project unless you match it pound for pound by a similar and related and local rail project. I think you have to take a more broad view of it. So I do think that we've invested in rail hugely. There's much more to do. We want to see as much of the electrification of the rail network, especially between our cities, as we possibly can, and we're well advanced in terms of starting that process, especially with Edinburgh to Glasgow and coming north as far as Dunblane. So I think we have done that, but you have to sometimes just take them on the merits. And I think in relation to the A9, the roads issue, you've mentioned some of the benefits already in terms of safety. It's also efficiency as well. I mean, you know better than me, and I know it well enough myself, in terms of the congestion there can be in that road. That congestion is very environmentally damaging, and it's damaging to journey times and to business as well. So there's all sorts of reasons for the investment, not just in the A9, £3 billion, but in the A96, £3 billion again. But we're also investing, talking about the A96, we're investing heavily in improvements, £170 million in the Aberdeen to Inverness rail line as well, potentially including new stations. So I think we have got the balance right, but you don't have money to do everything at the same time, I suppose.
And my final question, convener. You've mentioned electrification of rail, and clearly I've supported that, particularly what you've done, Glasgow to Edinburgh. Some of the rail experts in the past have argued that to achieve the full sort of economies of scale, you need the sort of perfect rectangle to be complete, which would be Glasgow, Edinburgh, Aberdeen and Inverness. Do you share that argument?
I think that's more a parallelogram than a triangle. But I think you're right to say. Now, obviously, when you look at that, say Glasgow and Edinburgh to Aberdeen, you've got the choke point in Montrose, obviously, so it's not just about the electrification, it's about infrastructure as well. But yes, we'd like to maximise the amount of our railway, especially the busiest parts of it, which it should be electrified, because it produces, it's not just benefits in terms of the environment. So of course we want to do that, but I think you'll know as well as I do that the future funding of these things is pretty uncertain just now, with the various reviews which the UK government has, and also the way it's looking at Network Rail just now. So, but despite that, we are carrying on with the biggest electrification programme we've ever had in Scotland, and we'll continue to push that as best we can.
Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Apologies, Cabinet Secretary, if this question appears to be a bit left field, but we heard evidence from Professor Jan Bebbington suggesting that the current carbon accounting methods used in calculating the carbon impact of the budget are no longer best practice, and it's a notoriously complex area. But do you agree with this assessment, and could you outline any proposed changes to assessing the carbon emissions from transport infrastructure projects and climate change impact of the infrastructure investment programme? Just, you know, almost a ancillary but related issue, that it strikes me that people that suggest that we're not going to meet our outcomes, I mean, Dr. Sam Gardner of WWF, always assume a kind of linear progress, whereas it seems to me that the game-changing technologies, you know, things like electric cars, just similar to smartphones, it's a kind of hyperbolic situation that you get. Suddenly they take off and change the game completely. So, you know, I'm just interested what your thoughts are on the general methodology that we use for calculating these climate change impacts, you know, whether it's currently fit best practice and what improvements we can make in the future.
Sure. If I want to get involved in hyperbole, but hyperbolic progress may well be right. I think, as you're saying, that sometimes you can't really accurately and definitively forecast the way these things will take off. People wouldn't have done that in relation to smartphones, and it's true in terms of much in the way of other technology as well. But the purpose of the carbon assessment of the draft budget that we've put together is to try and to help Parliament understand the emission consequences of spending by estimating the carbon emissions embedded in the goods and services funded by the Scottish Government. So that carbon assessment reflects a draft budget, and as such, it is a high-level nature, assessment that's been undertaken, and it's best applied to portfolio spending and budget expenditure as a whole. So it helps raise awareness of the carbon impact of spend, and that's perhaps, you mentioned cultural change, the biggest cultural change that we all have to undergo to understand when we make investment decisions what the carbon impact of that is. But it also helps by identifying the carbon emissions from upstream inputs, such as the production of gravel for road construction, what the carbon impact is for that, as well as those generated directly, so just heating spaces by government expenditure. So I think in order to better understand that complete picture on emissions associated with the use of public goods and services, the assessment needs to be read alongside the analysis that we've produced contained in the second RPP2, which provides assessments of key proposals and policies for meeting the targets. And I know, I think, as your question kind of hints at, there are changes and people undertake carbon assessments in different ways, but we are confident in the carbon assessment that we've made does provide what we want it to provide, which is an understanding for people such as yourselves to know what the impact of our policies are. And that's perhaps the most important. I'm sure techniques and methodologies will change over time, and people will compete for which is the best one. But if we can get across that basic point, what we believe are the carbon impacts of what we are doing, then that's surely the most important point of the carbon assessments.
My next question really, to a certain extent, covers territory that Dave Stewart already touched on, and that's about, you know, to what extent the expenditures that you make within your portfolio impact in terms of generating positive outcomes for other portfolios. Obviously, health being one, and one of the obvious things is that in terms of improving air quality. I just wondered, you know, are you able to make the case that some of that health portfolio should be reallocated to infrastructure?
Well, I'm sure if I was sitting in front of the Health Committee, there'd be a different argument, Mr. McKenzie. But I think, as well as the points that you've made in terms, yes, we do try to have, obviously, regard to the health and other environmental consequences. But perhaps the most obvious one, and the one that's most easily measured, is in terms of other portfolios, is employment and life chances. So community benefit clauses which allow people that have been long-term unemployed, or people, for example, on the New Forth Crossing, I've met two young people who have done their entire apprenticeships while working on that project and are now going off to different projects. And this has allowed them to get on an absolutely unique project, a unique experience, which has allowed them to develop their careers. And also by some of the stuff that we do in procurement through the portal for subcontracts and so on, maximising the opportunities for local business. So yes, we will produce benefits for health, not least as have been mentioned by a number of the committee members in relation to active travel. We produce benefits for the environment. One area where that was recently evident was Richard Lockhead made a statement about the VW emissions scandal, that if there is to be, as there should be, fines arising from that, then that could be used for environmental purposes. Obviously, it's a transport area, but the benefits could be used for environmental purposes, and that has benefits for health as well. So we are conscious of the other benefits, and we're also conscious of the competitive nature of different portfolios and the budgets that they want to have.
Thank you. And my final question, Convener, is just I was quite enthusiastic that the two new hybrid ferries are still relatively new, the Halligan and the Loch Inver. To read fairly recently, I think there's some work looking at to see if these can be made even more efficient by converting to hydrogen. And I just wondered how much scope you felt there was in in our fleet of ferries for further improvements in ferry efficiency.
Well, I think we're three of those ferries now, but I think the point of a hydrogen-powered ferry, it's a very interesting one, and there was development work done or research work done at St Andrews University in relation to this, and the potential really is for the European, I think it's Horizon or 2020 funding that might be available to help develop this. And you're right to say, if we could have in Scotland the development of a hydrogen-powered ferry, the benefits for us are huge, given the large ferry network that we have. But if you're the first to develop that technology, and of course we're doing something similar in terms of buses in Aberdeen just now, if you're the first to develop that technology, the benefits can be huge. So, and I think it may well be the case others are looking at how they can move down towards this path, especially given that we're all having to, with the new sulphur regulations, look at retrofitting current ferries to meet environmental standards. So if that can be done, there was one ferry, a small ferry in Bristol, where it was done, and it was so effective, when they put the hydrogen power unit in it, they had to put more ballast in to replace the weight that the diesel engine that had been taken out had taken out of it. So in terms of efficiency and obviously in the environment, there's a huge dividend there, and I'd be very much hopeful that we can, whether it's through shipbuilders or academics and with European funding, we can be the first to develop that.
Thank you.
The Infrastructure Investment Plan, which was published alongside the draft budget, it designates energy efficiency as a national infrastructure project. Clearly we're at a very early stage of that particular innovation. I'm just wondering if you can say a bit more about that and what you think the positive impact of that change will be in practice.
Well, I think it touches on all different aspects of both the infrastructure plan and different elements of infrastructure as well, many of which you've mentioned already in relation to transport, but obviously it relates to housing. I know you're about to talk to the Minister for Housing as well. And I think the idea in the IIP is to try and make sure it runs through all our infrastructure initiatives and our spend to make sure that energy efficiency is absolutely key to that. First of all, it helps us because it reduces costs to the government very often if we're talking about our own buildings and so on. But it also is the case that we can help the environment by reducing many of the infrastructure investment plans initiatives around energy efficiency are to do with district heating schemes and other schemes such as that which Fergus Ewing will be more familiar with, and perhaps Margaret Burgess will be than I am. But it's partly because we think this is the right thing to do. It's also partly because of the pressure we've had from both this committee and Parliament itself asking for this to be, make sure it's mainstreamed into what we do. I don't know if you want to say any more on that, Mike or Andrew.
Yeah, and I think one of the main principles in the scheme is going to be how we bring together the different programmes that currently achieve objectives in this area. So the idea is to develop a national, what we're calling Scotland's Energy Efficiency Programme, or SEEP. So you bring together both domestic and non-domestic buildings into that wider programme. So what the IEP signals is that, you know, this work will be taken forward over the next few years, and also as we go through successive spending reviews, sufficient funding is allocated to make sure that priority is delivered.
Okay, thank you. Clearly, Cabinet Secretary, the government has a commitment to spend more of its capital expenditure budget on low carbon infrastructure projects, but the issue that Mike McKenzie raised about carbon accounting methods, how confident are you that the government in taking forward that commitment is measuring accurately what it spends and how much of that spend actually is in relation to low carbon infrastructure projects?
Well, I think I am confident, but I did have the caveat when I responded to Mike McKenzie that we know these methodologies are changing and that there are competing views as to which is the most effective. So I think if the point of your question, convener, is to say the government has to be aware of that fact, then it's to consistently review how effective its carbon assessments are. I mean, that the government has to do that, and the government will do that, and obviously we'll be challenged on that by Parliament and by external interests, quite rightly, but I'm confident in what we do just now, what meets the central test, which, as I say, is if we can make sure that we're mindful of, when we make these investments, of the carbon impact of doing it, then of course over time you can improve how effective or how accurate those assessments are, and we'll consistently do that and be challenged to do it by others as well.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to pass over to Alec Johnson.
Thank you very much. Move on to a slightly less savoury subject of European accounting guidance. First of all, we'll start positive. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm what progress has been made with the 12 hub projects that were previously delayed by ESA 10 issue?
Yeah, I mean, I think first of all to say that the big impact, as I'm sure Alec Johnson knows, was on the AWPR and I think three or four health projects as well, which were captured by that reclassification. But as the Deputy First Minister indicated on the 26th of November, those projects, the 12 hub projects which you mentioned, have been authorised to proceed to financial close as soon as possible. Now, they are individual projects and they will be being looked at by those that are promoting them and also by the Scottish Futures Trust. So precise project timetables can be influenced by a range of factors. And it's also true to say that although those 12 projects were there, they weren't all at the same stage of readiness. We would estimate that potentially 11 of those 12 projects will reach financial close and possibly even commence construction in the very near future, in the next 2 or 3 months. But as I say, they are individual projects and it will depend upon the individual circumstances.
What is now the status of the larger NPD projects? Were the issues still to be resolved?
Well, as I mentioned in relation to the AWPR, that is resolved, not to our satisfaction. And I should just mention how frustrating I think it is that the European Stats Authority has taken this approach, which seems to me to be absolutely counter to what the Juncker plan is trying to do. If you're trying to put £300 billion into infrastructure investment, trying to change the accounting for that such that it might prevent a large number of these projects going ahead, I think is wrong-headed. Now, you'll find that same view expressed by many of the other European institutions and many other places across Europe. So that's been very frustrating. But the one that has been, as a member knows, classified as the AWPR. We have the Dumfries and Galloway Royal Infirmary and the Edinburgh Royal Hospital for Sick Kids are both in the ONS Forward Work Programme. So the ONS are looking at that. The draft budget for 2016-17 makes provision in capital budgets for those projects being classified to the public sector. So that provision is made, if that's what happens, as well as two smaller projects, the Scottish National Blood Transfusion Service, which is a fantastic project on the outskirts of Edinburgh, and the NHS Orkney Balfour project, which is in advanced procurement. Our assumption for budgeting purposes is that those projects will be classified to the public sector, so we've made provisions for that. I don't know if you want to add anything further to that, Andrew.
No, that's correct. That's correct. So the AWPR is the only project that's received a formal ONS classification, the ONS Baldercat, the two hospital projects that the Minister's identified as well. The two smaller projects may be too small for the ONS to look at in the same way. The issue there would be the similarities between those projects and the three that had received a classification.
Mm-hmm. Now, my next question was going to be, you know, what the implications for the public finances would be if these remain classified as public sector. But do you feel that you have all the bases covered?
Yes, I mean, but I think it's worth bearing in mind that the main important thing is, which we make that provision, we make that contingency available if that's what happens, but that money is then, it's an opportunity foregone to do something else with it. But we provided cover in the 2016 budget to a total of around £398 million. So if that's what you mean by having the basis covered, we've got the budget provision in place if that's what the outcome is. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Just looking ahead, if this is the way things are going to be done in the future, what are the implications for public expenditure going forward if we have to deal with this forevermore?
Well, the roads, AWPR and the health projects, which we've talked about, are infrastructure priorities. So our objective is to ensure that they are delivered, and there's no question that those projects will be delivered, just to give that assurance because of their economic and health benefits. The question, though, of what funding route we should use in some ways is a kind of second-tier issue. It's very important, of course, but it is the case that the need to provide upfront capital budget cover for these projects has, as I've mentioned, an opportunity cost for the wider programme. It just means there's other stuff that we can't do. But that's the environment we live in. And what I would say is, if you look at this government's track record since 2007, we've been pretty good, I think, not least to John Swinney, in innovating financial models. So whether it's the growth accelerator model, the tax incremental financing model, NPD. So I think we have to, if we want to, as we do, to maximise the infrastructure opportunities that we have, we're going to have to continue to be innovative. And one thing that's worth pointing out, I'm sure that Alec Johnson would have seen, like me, reports in the press that some people, third parties, commentators, believe that over 50% of the growth that we've had since the recession has been due to public infrastructure works. Some expressing concern that there's too much in that direction, not enough private sector investment. And I would like to see the private sector, which has been very supportive of our infrastructure programme, being as confident as we are about investment decisions. But we want to try and maximise these in future. It's my view, and I've said this, I think, to this committee before, and interestingly, Patrick McLaughlin, the Secretary of State for Transport, has said that for decades, Scotland has not had the investment it needs in its transport infrastructure, for example. And I think that's right. So we are trying to make up for what I believe has been decades of underinvestment. We've brought forward some pretty innovative financing models and a real commitment to that in terms of rail and road and other aspects. If we want to continue to do that, then we're going to have to be innovative in the way that we try and approach that. And that is our intention.
Will this accounting procedure, though, have the effect of slowing the pipeline of projects over time?
I think that's what we're trying to say there is, if we don't want that to happen, and we don't want that to happen, it's up to us to be innovative. If that avenue is being closed off to us, at least in whole or in part, and it seems that the, and Andrew would be better able to give you an up-to-date position on this, that the hubs themselves around the country, those projects which are much smaller in nature, seem to be not likely to be classified by ONS. So all those projects, and if you bear in mind the point I made previously, that these smaller projects can have a disproportionately beneficial impact on local economies, those are proceeding. If you want to continue with the large-scale investments that we've had, and we've had, I think, an unprecedented number and volume of these large-scale projects, Forth Crossing being just one of them, then it's up to us to be innovative about it. But it would be much better if we were going with the grain of what Juncker is trying to do, trying to, you know, make sure economies are benefiting from large-scale infrastructure projects without changes 5 years after this provision has come in. ESA 10 is 2010, that's when it came in. So, yes, that challenge is there. It's up to us to be innovative if we want to maintain the level of infrastructure investment that we've seen up till now.
Yeah. A couple of points to add. I think what we're seeing here is a particular impact of classification changes on projects that have already been either in procurement or pre-advanced development. So classification changes do happen periodically, and governments across the EU need to respond to that, and we're no different really in that respect. So the particular issue around projects that are kind of live, if you like, at the point at which classification rules change. The SFT have been asked to look at the future and how we might develop our infrastructure programme going further forward, reflecting the latest changes. But I think there's also a wider bit of consideration for us to look at, which is how does the kind of revenue finance infrastructure programme match against wherever we end up with in terms of the revised fiscal framework, wider capital borrowing powers, for example, and also in terms of the future spending review. So I think the task for us as government is to look at the range of options that we have to deliver the pipeline, because there's no reduction in the level of our commitment to having that big pipeline of projects. Second point is, as the Minister said, is around the Hub programme. So we have made changes to the Hub programme, and that affects not just the 12 projects that you've referred to, but also a future pipeline of Hub projects. So we remain fully committed to that programme of activity as well.
Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary, clearly from what you said, this is a challenging area for government, not least of all because the need to reclassify is happening during the lifetime of these projects, and that wasn't envisaged when the expenditure was initially committed. Is one of the dangers for Scottish Government that on the one hand there are potentially new opportunities through a fiscal framework for additional borrowing powers, which would allow the Scottish Government to do much more of these type of investment projects, that will no longer be possible because of the need to reclassify infrastructure projects?
Well, I think to the extent, convener, that is a danger. It's a danger we are aware of and try to avoid. Traditionally, capital-funded projects are a very efficient way of financing projects. It's true for local authorities as it is for the government. You've got the Public Works Loans Board money, some of the cheapest money you can get, so it's very efficient. But we always know, it's always been the case, that's been constrained. Would that the UK government treated the Scottish government the way that the Scottish government and the UK government treat local authorities in England and Wales, where you have prudential borrowing, where you borrow what's prudent to borrow rather than artificial constraints, and that would free up us and the SFT to do a great deal more within responsible limits. And I think what I would say about this administration, going back to before I was a minister, is that the responsible attitude of John Swinney, such that 5% of revenue budgets, no more than 5%, is devoted towards paying down debt for previous projects, a very responsible attitude. We're not a government that spent irresponsibly, but we have borrowed substantially in order to improve Scotland's infrastructure. So that is a reducing opportunity in terms of capital, although for us it's in the short term it's increasing because of the capital borrowing powers that we're getting, but it is only one tool in the box, and I think we've been very keen to try and exploit other ways of trying to maximise funding. And I would say that it may not always be evident to us, but what we have done has produced huge interest elsewhere. We had the largest MPD stream of projects I think in Europe. And interestingly, some of these projects which have been reclassified have been invested in by the European Investment Bank, who are not irresponsible lenders. So it seems to me the contradictions lie really with the attitude of the ESA and other aspects of European institutions, but that's the world that we live in. So we will continue to try and maximise what we can in terms of traditional borrowing and also look for other borrowing. So other countries, other sources of borrowing. There's a huge amount of money out there in the international markets just now, and some of it not in the markets at all, which are looking for a home to invest in. And that's not necessarily in terms of government infrastructure, just investing in Scotland. So we are very alert to all these opportunities, and we'll develop them over time.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm conscious we're probably straying into the Finance Committee's territory, but that's a very helpful statement of the government's position. Are there any further questions from members? In that case, it only remains for me to thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and your officials for your attendance this morning and for your comprehensive evidence, and also for the advertisement for the National Cycle Network in Clackmannanshire. So thank you very much, and we'll now pause briefly for a witness changeover. Good morning. We now resume this meeting of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Can I welcome Margaret Burgess, Minister for Housing and Welfare, who is accompanied this morning by Bill Barron, Unit Head, Housing Support and Homelessness, Caroline Dix, Unit Head, Affordable Housing Investment Policy and Planning, Orlando Heijmer-Mason, Social Security Policy and Delivery Division, and my apologies for any mispronunciation there, and Angus Macleod, Unit Head, Home Energy Efficiency Programmes for Scotland at the Scottish Government. And can I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement?
I don't have an opening statement, Convener, other than to respond to any questions the members may have.
Excellent. That's an innovative development for government ministers. You may be setting a precedent for your colleagues, but we're grateful for that. Minister, in that case, I'm going to ask Mike McKenzie to kick off questions this morning.
Thank you, Convener. Whilst the committee recognised the 16% increase in funding in fuel poverty and home energy efficiency, there's an overall reduction in funding for energy and energy efficiency of £22.8 million in the draft budget for 2016-17. Now, I understand that not all of this may be related to your portfolio area, it may be related to district heating support and so on. And also there are difficulties with the Green Deal having been stopped and initiatives like eco-bing. I'm not quite sure. It seemed to stop, start, stop. I'm not quite sure where it is now. But given the interface of or the complementary nature of a lot of the Scottish Government funding for fuel poverty initiatives, I just wonder if you feel that the proposed expenditure levels on home energy efficiency in this draft budget is sufficient?
Well, we're making over £100 million available for energy efficiency measures for 2016-17, which is an increase in the draft budget for the previous year, which was £89,000, I think, if I'm correct in saying that. So there is an overall increase in the draft budget. I do accept that the budget this current year was increased by what you pointed out there, Mr. McKenzie, the Green Deal, and which we used, we got £15 million consequentials, which we used in our cashback scheme, and that money is no longer available to us for that. But we do think that the £100 million, which is a considerable investment by the Scottish Government and going a considerable way to helping people make their homes more energy efficiency, we've already had over 900,000 measures installed in people's homes. One in three homes in Scotland are now at band, had energy efficiency measures installed. 41% increase in 2010 in homes at band C or above, and 11% in the last year. So we are making considerable progress given the very tight constraints on us. And I think what I would say about the eco is that the UK government, without any warning to us, stopped the Green Deal and Home Improvement Scheme without any warning, and our programmes were based on receiving that those consequentials. So I think given all of that and the changes that the UK government has made over the piece to eco and to the various schemes, I think our contribution is considerable given the overall constraints on the Scottish Government budget. And that's purely from our budget, the £100 million. There is other funding, I think, as you said, from the energy budget, which I can't really talk in detail on, but I know there's about £34 million of the energy budget in energy efficiency and renewables, district heating schemes, etc., coming from the energy budget. So I do think that we are, our commitment remains to energy efficiency. This is a one-year budget and we've committed over £100 million to it, and I think that is a considerable investment.
Thank you, Minister. And what I was getting at, I suppose, was that in talking to local authorities and talking to housing associations and some third sector organisations who are trying to, you know, deliver projects, that those projects often depended on kind of match funding, so they would get some money from Scottish Government, some from you know, eco through the, you know, the energy company obligation, some from Green Deal, and by amalgamating funding from different sources and initiatives, they were able to make projects on the ground stack up and financially workable. And that given the uncertainty of some of those other funding streams, Eco and Green Deal, they found it very difficult to actually take projects forward on the ground, and therefore were unable to spend the money that was had arisen from Scottish Government support. And I just wondered, you know, is that a frustration and is that a challenge in terms of, you know, meeting the climate change targets and aspirations that you have within your portfolio area?
It's certainly a frustration in terms of what's happening with ECO. It is a frustration because our schemes were based on, as you rightly pointed out there, attracting eco investment as well, but we still pool over our share of that, with 11.5% of all eco measures being delivered in Scotland, and that is due to the funding that the Scottish Government puts in. Our 100 million does help attract that, and this year we anticipate around 84 million being attracted in from the 100 million that we invest. So I think that is significant. But we've had to look at our schemes as well, because to see if we can tailor them in a different way to ensure that our money is being used, and it is being used, that we can look at it differently, where local authorities and projects are finding it more difficult to attract the eco funding, because once the energy company has reached its obligation, then, you know, it can just cut off and it no longer participates in a particular scheme. So these are difficulties and challenges that we have to face, but I think we have risen to that, and I think our investment shows very clearly that we are committed to energy efficiency and tackling not just climate change but fuel poverty. And, you know, we have the commitment, as we've already been made, to a national infrastructure project of multi-year funding, and that gives stability to companies involved in the energy efficiency market as well, and that's what we're proposing to do. And we will obviously use the powers we get from Smith in terms of our programmes. We'll be able to design them even more effectively and more integrated with the energy portfolio as well, to ensure that we are delivering and we are meeting our energy targets.
And if you take into account, you know, commitments that have already been made for the next parliamentary session to deliver 50,000, you know, affordable homes, and the energy efficiency under, you know, building standards that are, you know, implementing ever-increasing energy efficiency, do you feel that, are you confident that housing-related infrastructure expenditure plans in the draft budget and infrastructure investment programme plans will support the achievement of the Scottish Government's climate energy change targets?
Well, I think I would say two things on that. The first thing is, I think our ambition to build 50,000 affordable homes, I would presume, is welcomed by everyone in the committee. We have to build more homes, but we recognise in building more homes, yes, homes use energy, and that's accepted. And homes are built now, new homes are built to much higher energy efficient standards, and will continue to do so, and we'll continue to look at ways of improving the standards. The standards changed in October this year, I think. Am I correct in saying maybe one of it? October, the standards changed in October this year, and we'll be looking as we go forward at any other changes that can be made to the standards, to the 2013 Sullivan report as well, to deliver buildings that meet the EU standards. And in line with that, we also have the energy efficiency, the EASH programme for home improvements in the social rented sector, that they have to bring their homes up to a certain energy efficiency standard. So that's ongoing as well, at the same time as what we're doing in new homes. We're building new homes, improving existing homes, and encouraging across the sector with the new SEEP scheme to raise the awareness of energy efficiency in homes, to ensure that we can meet our climate change targets.
Thank you, Minister.
Okay, Adam.
Yeah, just following on this theme, Minister, in evidence, Sarah Tiam, representing the Low Carbon Infrastructure Task Force, suggested that all Scottish houses should be rated at least level C using energy performance certificate standards by 2025. And it was estimated that this would this would mean that the Scottish Government would have to incur expenditure of £140 million per annum up until that time for the next 10 years. But on the other hand, that would generate significant numbers of new jobs, 10,000 new jobs. It would mean savings for individual households on their household energy bills, and also generate savings for the NHS, etc. Do you agree with this, firstly? Do you agree with this analysis? And secondly, can you, if you do, or a version of it, could you clarify how the government aims to achieve the objectives as laid out by the task force?
I don't necessarily agree at this stage and don't have enough information that we should be looking at all houses in a band C at this point. I don't know if that one size fits all is the appropriate target for housing and buildings across Scotland, which is very diverse, as you'll be aware. But I do think we have to be aware of the carbon reduction plan. I do think that we have to make homes energy efficient. We're making available £100 million this year. We have committed to year-on-year funding for energy efficiency programmes. We have also said that in the next Parliament, we'll consult on energy efficiency for the private sector, including owner-occupied and private rented houses. And as part of that, we'll be looking at should there be a minimum standard and perhaps what it should be. So I think there is a consultation to be had in that. And I think, you know, we have made a commitment to consult on that. We've also made a commitment of the £100 million this year and to continue that on looking not just at houses but buildings across Scotland in terms of the multi-funding. This is a one-year budget, but in terms as we go on, future governments will set future budgets, but the commitment is made that it will be year-on-year funding for 10 to 15 years to improve the stock, the housing stock, and the stock of buildings in terms of heating and energy efficiency to reduce the carbon emissions across the country.
So you're really looking, we're looking at the next Parliament to determine the way forward on this front, albeit the direction of travel has been established, but how far we have to go hasn't been defined as yet.
I think, and so we have defined that we will go forward and we will continue to improve energy efficiency, absolutely. We recognise we've already done it in the EASH standards in the social sector. We're looking at it in the private sector as we go forward. But I think your question was specific about the EPC Band C. And what I'm saying is that we have not made that decision yet. We don't necessarily know at this stage if that's the appropriate way to go forward, given the diversity of Scotland's housing stock and buildings. But however, we will be consulting on standards in the next Parliament.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Can I just stick with that theme, Minister, if I may? The decision by the Scottish Government to make energy efficiency a national infrastructure project has been welcomed by over 50 civic and business organisations in Scotland. Do you see this as having potential to be a game changer in terms of energy efficiency?
I certainly hope so. I think in terms of energy efficiency, not just the game, but for public awareness as well, I think in terms of looking at regulating for energy efficiency as we move forward, it has to be recognised. That's why we've said it's a national project. It's involving a huge number of organisations and experts in the field as we go forward with Scotland's energy efficiency programme. So in what way you're meaning the game changer, if you're talking in terms of climate change reductions or warmer homes, both, I'm not sure where you're...
Well, I'm asking the question. The organisations who have welcomed this development, I think, clearly see the potential for this in all of the areas that you've outlined.
Absolutely. I mean, that's part of the purpose of it, but the purpose is to meet our climate change targets, but to improve our housing stock and the stock of our buildings across the country, and taking with us all our stakeholders in doing so.
Can I ask you, at this stage, is there a budget line attached to that commitment? Is there a specific commitment of expenditure for the designation of energy efficiency as a national infrastructure project?
The part of the project is we have this year, this is a one-year budget, and the budget this year is, and I'm talking solely on energy efficiency, home energy efficiency, which is in my portfolio. It's a one-year budget, and we've committed £100 million, or slightly over it, this year from our budget. As we go forward, that will be for future governments to determine the budget, the amount that's spent each year. But what we have said is it will be multi-year funded. It will be funded for 10 to 15 years as a national infrastructure project. It will be more integrated with what we're doing in terms of, I think, as Mike McKenzie mentioned earlier, the money spent in the energy budget in terms of energy efficiency and home efficiency as well, so we can integrate it better. And that's what the Scottish Energy Efficiency Programme will be looking at. It's in its very, very early stages just now. A meeting took place in December of stakeholders of the project as to how we go forward. And I think I'll be right in saying that in this year coming, part of the £100 million that we have, part of that pilot will be piloted on how we can look at wider, not just at homes, but at buildings as well. So that's been agreed with the local authorities that take part in that budget. So all of that is part of Scotland's Energy Efficiency Programme. Okay. I don't know if you want to add to that, Angus.
No, just to confirm that part of the domestic energy efficiency budget will be used to for councils to develop pilots to test new and innovative approaches to improving the energy efficiency of all buildings in Scotland. And we're working with energy colleagues on developing those approaches and working with councils, the aim being to cover more than just the housing stock, but to cover non-domestic buildings as well in an area.
Okay, thank you. Can I also ask you, Minister, about the heat expenditure programmes? And there's been a suggestion in evidence to the committee that we would require, as a country, to increase the expenditure on that in order to meet our climate change targets.
Yeah. And in terms of my portfolio, I think that strays into the energy portfolio. I would have to ask my energy colleagues to get back to you on that. That's not part of the housing portfolio specifically.
Okay, we'll look forward to receiving that. Perhaps then I can move on to the issue of housing supply. Clearly, the government has a commitment to increasing the number of affordable homes in Scotland. Are you still on target to achieve that figure of 30,000?
Well, we have already met that target. In October, our figure showed we were over 30,000 affordable homes in this current year, and we have increased our budget for affordable homes for 2016-17. I get these years confused with the years for 2016-17, and I've set a new target of 50,000 affordable homes over the next 5 years, and we would anticipate we will also meet that target.
Okay, and what is the difference in grant funding as a consequence of that increased target?
In the grant funding, we've increased the grant funding from, I think, from 262 to £365,000, which will be 256, sorry, to £365 million for grant funding. And grant funding is the funding, that, obviously, for social rented houses mainly.
Yeah. I'm aware that the announcement of the additional target of 50,000 affordable homes to be achieved over the lifetime of the next Parliament is one that has been welcomed by housing organisations, not least of all because they've been calling for the government to do more in this area. I'm thinking specifically of Shelter Scotland and the Existing Homes Alliance. What difference do you think this will make in terms of employment? Is there a figure attached to that?
I think the figure, and this is off the top of my head, is around 15,000, supports 15,000 jobs. 13 to 15,000 jobs will be supported, and that's per year, I believe, with the building of 50,000 new affordable homes.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask you as well about the government obviously has a range of targets and ambitions across the variety of tenure that we have in Scotland, you know, affordable housing, mid-market rent, social housing, home ownership. Clearly the government made a commitment which is now followed through in legislation to abolish the right to buy, but you would presumably argue that the government continues to fund home ownership through the Help to Buy scheme. Is it intended to continue with that scheme?
Yes, it's already been announced, I think, in the programme for government, £195 million over 3 years to continue with the Help to Buy scheme, and that announcement has been made.
And how many purchases will that support?
That will support around 6,500 purchases.
Over what timescale?
Over the three years. It's a three-year programme.
Okay, so the government's committed to continuing to fund that scheme over 3 years.
We've continued to fund that scheme, we've stated, by £195 million over 3 years, and that should support around 6,500 new homes.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to pass on to Claire Adamson.
Hey, thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Can I just put on record my support for the additional 50,000 affordable houses by 2021? If I could just understand the figures and the budget lines a bit better. Obviously, that in IIP, the commitment for the 50,000 affordable homes has got an indicative budget of around £3 billion. And you've spoken in detail about the housing improvement initiatives related to energy efficiency. But obviously, more houses means more carbon production. So it's not it's a movable feast, if you like, for your portfolio all the time in trying to meet the climate change targets. So I just wondered if that £3 billion budget line was just for the building of the affordable homes at an energy efficient level that you've discussed already, or is there any indicative figure of how the energy efficiency, if there's any energy efficiency money included in that budget line, and if not, is there any indicative figure on the work of how that might have to increase in percentage terms just to deal with the new 50,000 homes?
The budget that's committed to £3 billion over the next 5 years is for the delivery and the building of new affordable homes. As I said in response to a question earlier, those homes will be built to higher standards, they will be more energy efficient in any case, and we will look as the years go on, as building methods improve, how that can be improved to make them even more energy efficiency, if that's at all possible. At the same time, we still have the programme running for the local authorities to meet the energy efficiency scheme for existing housing stock, so that should be improving the energy efficiency and reducing the carbon emissions of existing housing stock. And at the same time, the SEEPs programme will be bedding in, which will deal with buildings and houses in the private sector as well. So all of that together will be reducing emissions from existing stock, and hopefully the building methods of the new stock should not increase them too much. So, you know, I think in terms of, I mean, I'm not going to say at this point, yes, it's going to be an absolute balance or there's going to be, you know, a net reduction, but we will be looking at that and our analysts will be looking at that as well, because overall, as a government, we are determined to meet, we have to meet our carbon reduction targets. We know that, but at the same time, we know we have to increase the supply of housing.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
It's getting the balance.
Thank you, Minister.
David.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. You'll be probably aware that Professor Jan Bebbington has suggested that the current carbon accounting methods used in assessing the carbon impact of the Scottish Government budget was no longer best practice. Do you agree with that assessment?
And I'm not just making excuses, it's not something that necessarily lies within my portfolio of how the assessment is made. Our analysts are always looking at ways of assessing carbon reduction, carbon emissions, and as we move forward to RPP3 in terms of housing, we'll also be looking at the analysts are working in that, how we can determine the emissions in our proposals in terms of RPP3. So again, it may be something we have to go to the analysts or the energy portfolio, unless Angus has anything he can add to that. It certainly is not something that comes across my desk.
Mr. Macleod, do you have anything to add?
No, just to back up what the Minister was saying, carbon accounting methods, it's a fairly niche area of expertise in terms of statistical and economic reporting, as I understand it. And I can't claim to be an expert in either of those areas, I'm afraid. But obviously I can liaise with colleagues working in this area and provide further information.
Okay. So presumably there's no plans to change the assessment of carbon emissions from housing building programmes or any energy efficiency initiatives?
The methodology for assessing the energy efficiency of buildings is what's called SAP, Standard Assessment Procedure. That does get updated from time to time, and that's what's used to measure both fuel poverty and, I believe, to measure carbon emissions. With the Scottish House Condition Survey is based, the energy efficiency that they measure is based on SAP, and that's now been updated to use, I believe, the most recent version of SAP, which is a 2012 version. So it does get updated on a regular basis, and we generally follow in line with that. But again, apologies, I'm not an expert in that area.
That's okay. I mean, so there is a prospect that the new SAP guidance from 2012 does take on board some more up-to-date carbon accounting methods?
Yes, right. I believe.
I get the sense this is not a very fruitful area of questioning, so maybe I'll move on. Could I just ask a final question then, is on the Scottish Government's corporate planning. So, for example, potential savings in other budgets, such as health, from improved quality of housing, for example, is there arguments there that your budget should be improved in some way because there's effectively a saving on the health budget? Is that something, Minister, that you've had any experience of in the wider corporate management of Scottish Government?
I mean, there's discussions ongoing all the time around issues like that within the Scottish Government in terms of, you know, what one portfolio can contribute to another portfolio or save another portfolio. And we have on it, for example, in the Fuel Poverty Forum, we have a health representative on it now. In our homelessness group, we have somebody from health. And it is about looking about the impact that other services are having in people's health and well-being. We recognise that. But if you were asking me, can we say exactly the impact of an energy efficient home has on their health and how much that's reduced the health budget, it then becomes more complex. I'm not saying it's not something we shouldn't do, and we're always looking at that holistic way, because the same thing could be said if someone gets a job, the impact that has on their health, their overall health and well-being. So how much of it was the warm home or even the home, and how much of that was based on the fact that they're getting a job. So yes, that has been looked at all the time within the Scottish Government, but there's an absolute recognition that if somebody lives in has a roof over their head, has a permanent home, has a warm home, then it does impact on their overall health and well-being, and it increases their chances of getting a job, it increases their chances of participating in their community. So we have looked at that, and we are talking about that across portfolio, and not just in health, but right across portfolios.
Thanks, that's very helpful. Thank you, Minister. Okay.
Alex, did you have any questions?
No, I'm okay at this
point. Members? Okay. Minister, could I perhaps just ask, you mentioned earlier that the government's commitment wasn't just to providing new homes, particularly new affordable homes, but also upgrading the existing housing stock. Do you want to say a little bit more about that and how the government intends to bring the existing housing stock up to the minimum energy efficiency standards?
In terms of, we already have the arrangement in terms of social housing that has been brought up to energy efficiency standards under the EASH programme, Energy Efficiency for Social Housing. And what I said is that we're be consulting on REAPS, which is, remind me?
Regulation
of Energy Efficiency programme, which will cover private housing, owner-occupied housing, and SEEP will look very much at that at the new programme, and it's very much at an early stage. But yes, there is a recognition that we have to bring the housing stock across Scotland. Has to be more energy efficient if we want to reduce carbon emissions as well as reduce fuel poverty. So that is part of what SEEP will be doing and looking at as part of the programme. And we have had some discussions before we reach the SEEP stage on how we go about that. And I think the question that Adam Ingram asked about the minimum standard, and that's the kind of thing we'll be consulting on. Should there be a minimum standard? If so, what should it be as we go forward and roll out the SEEPs programme?
Okay. Are there any other areas that you would like to cover off? I know we've looked at how, or expand upon, we've covered housing supply, the issue of the Help to Buy successor scheme, energy efficiency as a national infrastructure mm-hmm. priority. Is there anything else that you would like to touch on?
Other, just I think someone mentioned about housing across all tenures. I think, you know, as a government, we're very keen to ensure that when we do increase supply, it is across all tenures in terms of, and our focus is on affordable housing, but we're also helping low-cost home ownership and helping the right to buy, the Help to Buy, which is about also giving a kickstart to the construction industry and keeping jobs going. So all of that, you know, is quite important that is recognised, that we're looking at increasing supply across all tenures, and that's what we're aiming to do. But our focus is on the 50,000 affordable homes.
Okay, thank you, Minister. Do members have any final questions? In that case, it only remains for me to thank you, Minister, and your officials for your attendance and your evidence this morning. Thank you very much. I'll now allow for a brief pause for witnesses to leave the room.
This meeting of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Agenda item 3 is for the committee to consider petition PE1539 by Anne Booth on housing associations to come under the Freedom of Information Scotland Act 2002. And can I welcome Anne Booth and Sean Clarkin, who are in the public gallery this morning and who've been waiting patiently for this agenda item.
to come onto our agenda. When the committee previously considered the petition at its meeting on the 18th of November, it agreed that as the Scottish Government has now decided to formally consult on extending Freedom of Information Scotland Act to include registered social landlords and to review the Scottish Social Housing Charter, it would seek the petitioner's views on whether it would be content for the committee to close the petition on that basis. The petitioner's response is attached at Annex A, and in it Ms Booth expresses a preference for the committee to keep the petition open. The committee is now invited to consider and agree whether it wishes to take any further action in relation to this petition. Should the committee wish to keep the petition open, it could be carried over to Session 5, given the timings involved with the Freedom of Information Consultation and Charter Review. Under these circumstances, updated guidance from the Public Petitions Committee sets out that the committee has the option to add the petition to its legacy paper for its successor committee to consider further in Session 5. Or alternatively, the committee also has the option to close this petition should it consider that no further action is required. Can I invite comments from members on what further action we should take as a committee? Dave Stewart.
Camille, can I suggest that we just keep the petition open and it goes in the legacy committee for the next session?
Okay, can I invite further comments from members? Claire Adamson.
I'd be content with that, convener. I think the last time we discussed the petition, we were unclear how the petitioners felt about this, but given that they have now said that they would prefer it to keep open, I think that's a reasonable course of action.
Okay. Mr Johnson?
Just nodding in agreement.
Okay. I think there's a consensus across the committee that we should keep the petition open in that case. So are we agreed that we will leave the petition open and add the petition to our legacy paper for further consideration? Okay. And that petition will be kept open and will be considered further in Session 5 of the Parliament. I now move this meeting into private session.